So thank you for the introduction. Happy to be here. So today I'm going to be talking about privacy-preserving smart contracts. So let me just start by saying what smart contracts are. So this was a concept kind of introduced by Nick Szabo in 1994. And the goal of smart contracts is to automate contract management. So in his essay, he talks about the scenario where you have a user who goes and buys a car from a car dealer, and then he gets an electronic key, which is supposed to work if and only if he pays the monthly installments on time. And you know, today, you can connect everything to the internet, so automating this is not necessarily hard. So what makes smart contracts really smart is that they have this like self-enforcing property. So in a sense that if something screws up, you know, maybe you pay the monthly installment on time, but the key still doesn't work, then somehow the situation resolves automatically. In the sense that you don't have to go and contact like some external dispute resolution mechanism or a court of law, it just somehow resolves automatically. So what is you know, why is designing smart contracts hard? So let's look at a very simple example of a contract. I call this an information exchange. It's a standard fair exchange problem. So you have Alice and Bob with their pieces of information, and they just want to exchange it. So we all know what is going to go wrong. You know, an honest Alice will send over information first, but then Bob becomes corrupt, and then he does not send over. So we are dealing with counterparty risks in the context of contracts. But today, you know, these information exchanges happen all the time. So, you know, how do we mitigate counterparty risks? The way we do it is by using escrow services. And so Alice and Bob both trust like some escrow, and then they're going to use the help of the escrow to exchange information. So in order to set things up, you know, Alice and Bob need to specify some conditions on the other person's information that they're looking for. And then they send this over to the escrow. The escrow checks if the information is legit. If everything is going well, then just performs the exchange. Right? So this is how it would happen in practice. And you can make it self-enforcing if you're willing to trust an escrow. Everything can be automatic. But one question that we want to ask is, well, are escrows really necessary in this situation? Maybe we could do something clever and maybe save ourselves a couple of $1,000 by not using the escrow. But here we have a classic impossibility result due to Cleve, basically says that these information exchanges are impossible to enforce without a trusted third party. So what does this mean for smart contracts? It basically means that you cannot enforce these contracts without using a trusted party. So you know, we need some way to bypass Cleve's impossible result. So we're basically going to change the model in a small way. So a basic intuition here is that you know, information has value, and somehow this value can be captured by money. So let's look at a different type of escrow, not an information escrow anymore, but a money escrow. So we bring money into the picture. And what happens is that parties are going to deposit their money with the money escrow. Then they start the exchange. If the exchange goes bad, then now the money escrow will intervene, and then it will compensate the honest party. So you're still not getting a pure perfect information exchange, but what happens is that the honest party gets compensated. So it does not get the bad party's message, but it gets compensated using some money. And in practice, if you set the value of the safety deposit equal to the value of the information, then somehow this seems to give a reasonable notion of a contract implementation. So we have jumped from an information escrow to a money escrow, but we are still using a trusted third party in some sense. So we are not fully self-enforcing without any trusted party. So it's not clear why this is any better. So here, what you can show is basically a reduction from this money escrow to a different type of primitive, which I call a self-enforcing information-to-money exchange. So this is a self-enforcing information-to-money exchange. There are two different objects. One is information, one is money. Money has ownership information. You know, you send information to someone else, both of you have the information. But if you send money, you no longer have money. So it's a different type of exchange. So I'll make this more clear. I'm going to call these as claim or refund transactions, the self-enforcing information-to-money exchange. So what happens here is that Alice makes a conditional transaction to Bob. She puts some money, but she also specifies the condition. And what Bob can do is, well, he can claim the money as long as he provides some information that satisfies the condition. Right? And the thing here to note is that this transaction is somehow atomic, in the sense that once Alice puts the money, she cannot stop the payment. And also in the other case where you know, maybe Bob is malicious and he's not going to divulge his information, then what happens in this case is that Alice gets back her money. So either Bob can claim the transaction, claim the money, or the money gets refunded. So this is what I call a claim or refund transaction. But still, this is, you know, I'm calling this a self-enforcing information to money exchange is atomic, but you know, we know that information to information exchange is impossible due to a result of Cleve. So why is this any better, right? So why is a self-enforcing information to money exchange? Why does it make sense? So the punchline here is that Bitcoin implements information to money exchange. So we don't know if Bitcoin implements information exchange, but we know it implements information to money exchange. So if you're willing to take a leap of faith and you assume that Bitcoin is real money, then Bitcoin makes this information to money exchange very explicit. Because in Bitcoin, if you have the knowledge of the secret key, then you own the money that is associated with the public key. Right? So if you look at the blockchain, which is a public list of transactions, you see that Bitcoin transactions, even standard transactions, are already explicitly conditional. So if Bob wants to spend money that was sent to him by Alice in transaction one, if he wants to spend it to Carol, he basically has to produce a signature under his public key, which only he can do. So this proves that, you know, Bob is rightfully spending the money. No one else can do because they cannot produce Bob's signature. So in some sense, each of these transactions are conditional. You have to prove that you are the legitimate sender. And in fact, Bitcoin transactions are actually more general. They accept more conditions. You can put any arbitrary condition there. There are some limitations on that. But you can basically, you know, think of it as in an idealized primitive, you can think of putting any condition there. But who is checking and validating all these things? This is where Bitcoin miners come in. They validate the conditions, they maintain the blockchain, they make sure that only the correct transactions are included. Right. But maybe you're not happy with this equation. Maybe Bitcoin is not real money, and maybe tomorrow the American government will just ban Bitcoin. So the stuff that I'm saying, does it have any relevance then? Well, here I want to point out that we are going to be constructing our protocols based on this like arrow notation, an abstract claim or refund transaction. So this abstraction is definitely Bitcoin inspired, but it's Bitcoin independent. What I mean by here is that, well, you can implement this claim or refund transaction either using a pure information to money escrow. There's no Bitcoin, no blockchain. You just have like some Bank of America or PayPal. It is implementing this information to money escrow. They already deal with money. You know, they already deal with sensitive information. They could implement these conditional transactions. Or you could have any blockchain implementation, your favorite cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, Litecoin, Ethereum. You know, there are a wide variety of those, and most of them support claim or refund transactions. And in either case, you have to worry about privacy and scalability, and I'll motivate these things a little bit. So for privacy here, you know, if you're using a pure information to money escrow for making these conditional transactions, then, well, you're obviously leaking the information to the escrow. But if there is a data breach at the escrow, then, you know, that will leak your information as well. So this is not necessarily a good idea. You need some privacy. And in the blockchain, things are much worse because, you know, the miners have to validate the conditions. So you have to give them the information to prove that it satisfies the conditions. So in some sense, you know, the information is made public on the chain anyway, right? So in terms of scalability, it's reasonable to assume that, you know, any number of transactions that you do, you're going to pay some kind of fees for every transaction. So you want to minimize the transaction. And you also want to minimize the condition on the transactions because, well, the transaction fee might depend upon the particular condition. If the condition takes 6 hours to verify, then you're probably going to be charged a larger fee. And in the blockchain implementation, a large condition can actually even break consensus. This is because, well, if you have a large enough condition, then the miners are not really incentivized to go and check through the conditions. They might just reject your transaction. Some of them might include it, some of them might reject it. Even in other cases, if you have a large program floating around in the Bitcoin network, then it's going to affect the time to consensus.
So for privacy, do you want to hide both the amount that is being committed and the information that...
No, so we want to hide the information...
Basically, the information that satisfies the predicate.
Yes, the information that satisfies the predicate. We will reveal the amount of money. You can use like other techniques to hide the money as well. So anyway, the bottom line is no matter which implementation you choose, you need some privacy-preserving mechanisms. You also need to minimize the on-chain complexity. By on-chain complexity, I just mean the number of claim or refund transactions and the size of these conditions that I'm putting on the transaction. So the main theorem that you can get is that it turns out that this claim or refund transactions, along with secure multi-party computation, is a very powerful primitive. And you can get smart contracts, which are both scalable as well as privacy preserving. I'll explain what scalable means. And when I say of smart contracts, you can think of this as like information exchanges, or you can think of like a game of poker. Those are the applications that you may want to keep in mind. So I won't have time to show you the constructions, but maybe the time is better spent giving you a few perspectives on how you compare this with some other primitive which we know and we are familiar with a lot more. I'm going to take oblivious transfer, and the goal is to get secure multi-party computation versus claim or refund to get smart contracts. Okay. So OT is really the king of all two-party crypto primitives. So Yuval Ishai called it a 100-year primitive. It's a very strong statement. A lot of things can happen in 100 years, but still some of the OT hybrid model is expected to survive. And there are many reasons to believe this statement. OT has multiple instantiations, multiple interpretations. You can interpret it as a noisy channel. You can interpret it as the standard 1 out of 2 OT. You can interpret it as this additive sharing of a multiplication. Like Evgeny was talking about these spooky quantum correlations in the CHSH game. So these are all like some variants of OT. And for me, from the lens of secure multi-party computation, the two real important properties that OT gives you is Kilian completeness and very good preprocessing. By Kilian completeness, what I mean is, you get if you have a network of n parties and pairs of them have OT correlations, then somehow they can use this OT correlations to get useful multi-party general correlations. And you can do this for reactive, non-reactive. It's very general. And the other thing which is really appealing about OT is that you get very good preprocessing. You start with random OT, you can get actual OT. It has extension properties. You start with OT on short strings, you get OT on long strings. Instance extension, you start with like a small number of OTs, you can bootstrap it to a large number of OTs. So it has a lot of really cool properties. So let's see how claim or refund compares to oblivious transfer. It's going to be a tough comparison, but let's see. So I'm going to go in reverse. So claim or refund transaction, and here the goal is to get smart contracts. For OT, the goal was to get like MPC. Here it's to get smart contracts. And you can, in fact, get some flavors of pre-processing and extension. So if I have time, I will explain what I mean by flavors of pre-processing and extension. Surprisingly, you can also get Kilian completeness. So both of these, note that both are like two-party primitives. And Kilian completeness says whether you can boost them up to multi-party primitives. And you can get Kilian completeness in the non-reactive case, and also in a restricted version bounded reactive case, you can get it. But one important property which we also get is what I call as triadic closure or routing. These are non-standard terms. I'm just inventing them on the fly. But this is something that we know that OT cannot give you. So OT, you cannot get triadic closure or routing, but you can get it for claim or refund. And OT is a 100-year primitive. Is claim or refund a 100-year primitive? The answer is no, but I'm biased, so I'll give it a probably not. So claim or refund, we abstract it in a way such that it's not Bitcoin specific, it's not cryptocurrency specific, it's just an oracle just like OT. But it seems that most realizations and most applications are somehow tied to crypto. So I don't know if crypto is going to survive in 100 years, so it's not clear. It's also tied to objects, it's dealing with like money, and also an impossible result of Cleve. It's not even clear if the smart contracts problem is going to be relevant in 100 years. So it's not clear. But one thing that I would want to mention is that if you have a two-party primitive which is going to compete with claim or refund, then these competitors need to show this like triadic closure or routing, which I'll explain in the next few slides. So let me start with Kilian completeness. So here the corresponding problem, I was talking about this two-party information exchange. In the multi-party setting, we want a set of parties, they want to perform an N-way exchange, the standard cryptographic setting, all of them might collude against one. In this case, you want to make sure that if someone aborts the exchange, then all honest parties get compensated. So this is what we want. This is the standard thing. Right? And the question is whether these two-party claim or refund transactions, whether they can give you this N-way exchange. And you show that this is actually possible, and this is exactly how the four-party transaction graph looks like. So there's an order in which these transactions need to be made. There are lots of details. But let's just focus on the structure of this transaction graph. The important thing to note here is that the number of transactions is not quadratic. You know, for something like OT, to get Kilian completeness, you need quadratic number of OT channels, all past OT channels. But here, you only need linear in the general case. So it's actually something like a cycle, and everybody gets transactions to the last guy. So this linearity of in realizing the Kilian completeness actually gives rise to this property, which I call as triadic closure. So what this means is that you want Alice and Bob to perform some kind of an exchange, a two-party information-to-information exchange. Then what they can use is they can use an untrusted server. So this is going back to the four-party transaction graph. Just view the third and the fourth party as a server. So the server is emulating the third and the fourth parties in its head, and then they're together implementing a four-party contract. But it's actually only three parties. So this actually gives rise to like some kind of meaningful client-server architectures. And another interpretation of this is really something like a router. So the server is acting like a router. Alice and Bob might be on different claim or refund implementations. You know, they could be on different networks. So Alice is on the Bitcoin network, and Bob is on the Litecoin network, or one of them is on Bank of America, another one is on like PayPal. But they can still use the services of this server without having to trust the server and still route and do their contract. So this is something that we know that OT does not give you something like this. If Alice has OT correlations to the server and Bob has OT correlations to the server, then we don't know how Alice and Bob can perform can get OT correlations without assuming any extra assumptions. So how much time do I have? I have a lot of time.
2.5 minutes.
Okay, so I'll just hint at like some other extension properties that I talked before. So one is a standard length extension. So here, the goal is for Alice and Bob to exchange their information. And then using, it's a folklore technique, but we can also port it to the Bitcoin setting. You can use secure computation to kind of reduce it to an exchange of the keys instead of exchanging the actual information. So you can make the complexity of the Oracle queries independent of the size of the information. The other thing is preprocessing, and also it gives you a flavor of instance extension. So here we want a set of parties, they want to perform multiple exchanges. And typically you would expect the conditions on these claim or refund transactions to depend on the actual information exchange. And the question is, well, can we get like universal conditions? And here we can actually show that you can get an unbounded number of exchanges from just a single set of claim or refund transactions. Again, this result you have to interpret it as an optimistic setting result. So as long as the parties are behaving honestly, you never have to touch the claim or refund transactions. Something goes wrong, then you have to go and get your compensation, and then you have to restart from scratch again. But otherwise, if everybody's behaving honestly, you just need one single set of claim or refund transactions. You don't have to touch the blockchain at all. So going back to the summary, so you can actually, the combination of claim or refund transactions and cryptography, and particular secure computation, it gives you smart contracts which are privacy preserving and also scalable in a lot of meaningful ways. I just talked about my own work, but there's also a bunch of other related work, some of them in the claim or refund transaction functionalities model, others in like specific Bitcoin transactions, and also some in the ledger-based transaction model. So one thing that I want to say is that because these claim or refund transactions are abstract, you can also port them to, like, let's say, a ledger-based abstraction, and you can still get the same results. So thank you for your time.